So if everyone could please mute yourself, that would be great, so we don't hear your cats and dogs barking or your kids or any other distractions. A couple more people coming in. And if you're just new to, if you're just joining us, we're just saying hello in the chat, introduce yourself, your name, your farm name, where you're coming from, where you're tuning in from. And if you could please mute yourself tonight. Okay, so while we're waiting for everyone to introduce themselves and say hello in the chat, I'm going to try something I've never tried before and put up a poll to you all. I'm going to ask you both, or excuse me, I'm gonna ask you all two questions. Have you made biochar or have you ever used biochar? So I'm launching the poll. So if you could fill out the poll, that would be great. This just gives us a chance to see who's here and everyone's experience with biochar. This is pretty cool. It's like watching the results come in. I'll leave it up. So if you all are just joining us, welcome. I have a poll up right now that's asking two questions. If you could all fill it out, that'd be great. Have you ever made biochar? Have you used biochar? We just want to give a sense of who's here tonight. And if you haven't filled out the poll, it's up right now. And if you want to say hello in the chat, where you're coming from, and if you have a farm name, feel free to pop that in there. Great. Okay. I'm going to end the poll and I'm going to share the results. Sorry, there's my cat in the background. Can everyone see that? Francesco, can you see
that? Yes, I can see it.
Okay, great. Wonderful. Okay, without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Francesco. Let me get my notes up. I just wanted to first, before I do that, welcome everybody. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Kelly Henwood and I am with WSU Extension up in Jefferson County, but I am our regional small farms coordinator for Clallam and Kitsap County as well. So I'm happy you're all here. And these dirt talks were really started with one of our other staff members who's here tonight, Jeff Sappington from Kitsap County, as a way to just have an opportunity for farmers to network with each other. This is a chance for farmers to share their knowledge with other farmers and to other farmers. This isn't so much a university knowledge-driven workshop. It's really a farmer-to-farmer networking opportunity. And it's really fun when there's a topic to focus on. So tonight we have the topic of biochar, and I wanted to just turn it over to Francesco Tortorici. Sorry, I have a cat in the background. Francesco's with Olympic Biochar, and he's going to start out the evening with some overview of biochar, and then we're going to go into some more question and answer and discussion with some of our farmers who are on the webinar tonight to share some of their experiences and knowledge with biochar. So if you want to utilize the chat for any questions or clarifications, I'll have you all just mute yourselves and wait until Francesco gets through some slides before we can unmute yourself and ask some questions. So I think that's it. Francesco, do you want to unmute yourself and take it away?
Yeah, I think I'm unmuted. Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Okay. Good evening. Yeah, and I want to start with, like, first of all, thanking Kelly and thanking all of you for the fits and starts with this. This was scheduled to happen the end of, you know, a few weeks ago, and unfortunately, I had a little medical emergency, and I'm doing great. And actually, it turned out better. I think we have more people tonight than were originally signed up. I'm not a farmer, And when Kelly asked me to do this, I'm not a farmer, and that's okay. But my intention, some of you have seen my presentations before. It's not going to be my normal presentation, because I look at myself as being a facilitator for many of the farmers that are on this webinar right now. And they are highlighted in my presentation. And so that any questions, and these have, and most of them have either made and or use biochar right now on their farms. And so there's a wealth of information here and of experience that's open to everyone that is here tonight. So with that, I'm gonna just start and go through it. Let's see. Okay, first of all, who am I? Francesco Tortorici, and I am a graduate engineer, civil engineer. And the reason I do this as a little bit of my journey, it's kind of an interesting circuitous route that I've taken to get to biochar. I graduated university back in the late 60s, and I was actually worked in a rocket factory, design factory. I was actually worked in with Rocketdyne, the firm that designed and built the rockets that went to the moon. That was an exciting time for a 21-year-old kid from Brooklyn. Fast forward then through the years, I lived in Norway for a while, and I was the co-founder and director in the 70s of the Norwegian Center for Appropriate Technology. And my heart's always been there. I mean, life gets in the way, and I've done other things like construction management, et cetera, but it has been this appropriate technology. About 10 years ago now, I got hooked up. This is clean cook stoves. That's how I got into biochar. It was through an organization that's in Kirkland, Washington. They meet yearly, and it's called ETHOS, the Engineers in Technical and Humanitarian Opportunities of Service. And they have stoves that are called these little top-lit updraft stoves. We show some examples in the slides that make biochar. It really spoke to me. And I just tell people, be careful. If you get bit by the biochar bug, no telling how far down the wormhole you're gonna go. What is biochar? Real quick, and I'll just, everyone can see it, but it's a byproduct of pyrolysis. It's a carbon rich, which is heating of any biomass, the high temperatures in an oxygen limited environment. It's highly porous, long lasting, and some biochars have been carbon dated to between 5,000 and 8,000 years old. And it's not just, it's the Amazon in Africa. They use biochars been used and in some African villages. When they ask people, how long have you been here? They'll say this long or this long. And what they're talking about is how much dark earth they have in their soil, because that's the way they look at it. Biochar is very porous. So if one had just a teaspoon, about a tablespoon in one's hand, you would have as much surface area as a football field. And that's some of the properties that biochar does. And this is just Google images that I pulled down, just images on biochar. And now I'm gonna go over to just a quick little show, a very short video that, Now we got it.
today we're creating the biochar. Tomorrow we're going to inoculate the biochar with all kinds of my beneficial microbes for the soil. Here at Orcasong Farm on Orcas Island in the San Juan Islands, making some biochar today. And we're using old tractor fuel and home heating oil tanks that were on property. By cutting off the tops of the tanks, we converted these tanks to open cylinder biochar burn tanks. So we build it like it's like a lasagna layer. And when it gets charred and a little ashy, then we add the new layer of wood and we build that up so we keep the flame on top. And at the end, when the wood is all the way to the top of the cylinder, and then we arrest the burn, either with water or with a lid in this case. And then we'll let it sit for 36 hours and then we'll dump it out and have a huge cylinder of ready to go biochar. We have 45 acres of forest here. It needs a lot of management, thinning and culling. And we're using that material to create char, which then we can then inoculate, put in the soil, build the nutrient profile of that soil so that we get more nutrient-dense vegetables, more nutrient-dense fruits. So this is what we just made. Just beautiful, crunchy, nice biochar. You can see all the surface area in there for beneficial microbes and bacteria to inhabit in the soil. We're going to use it in our huge garden space, which is a market garden, CSA garden, community garden, supplies a good amount of food to all kinds of stores and restaurants and direct to consumers here on the island. And this is sequestering carbon in the soil for, you know, hundreds, if not thousands of years. And this is all readily available to us on the property here and all over the island. So anywhere there's a lot of biomass, forest biomass, thinning, culling, cutting, managing, this is available to us. Together as a neighborhood, we can cooperate to maybe share these burners. They may move around the island, move around the neighborhood, and we go help each other create biochar. And that can be for forest restoration, can be for pasture restoration, can be for people's gardens. Anywhere there's lots of forest, people are maybe managing their forest, but then creating slash piles and just burning it. Just to get rid of it. Anywhere there's a lot of biomass, we can create another highly valuable product from it instead. We're sequestering that carbon back into the earth.
Well, as I switch back over to the So that was a workshop that we were at on Orcas Island a couple of years back. And actually the people that led that workshop did a workshop here which we'll show later on, did one at Finn River a couple of years ago. And so now that was an introduction to show how some people are making biochar and have these kilns on Orcas Island, these flame cap kilns that they were using there, and they share them amongst the community. We do the same here in Port Townsend and Jefferson County, and we'll get into that in a little bit. Most of the farms, and I'm gonna go through this rather fast, and the people, their representatives, so I see Lowell Dietz is here. So he's available for questions, and almost every farm that I have in this presentation, there's someone from that farm that can answer questions about what they do, how they do it. And so Lowell is someone that I met when I did my very first biochar presentation several years ago. And Lowell grows mushrooms at his farm in Squim. And he was asking if he could use these top-lit updraft stoves, a bigger model, to pasteurize straw. And that's what Lowell is doing here. These stoves will come up to over 930 degrees centigrade. What Lowell does is, and a byproduct of these stoves you'll see is biochar, 930 degrees Fahrenheit, excuse me. And he uses that to pasteurize his straw in his mushroom cultivation. This is the biochar that comes out as a byproduct at the end of pasteurizing straw. Then Lowell uses this to make something called squim terra preta. If one Googles terra preta de Indio, you'll see the origins of when we here in the North found biochar for the first time that the Amazonian Indians were using. Lowell makes his own squim terra preta, which is made up of 75% worm castings, 25% biochar with leachate, and 5% sand. As Lowell told me, there's a couple of funny things here, is I used to get Lowell's leachate. He used to just give it away. Not anymore, because it's too valuable for him to use in his raised beds. And what one thing that Lowell does say is, the Black Earth Revolution has begun. That's something that Lowell said to me years ago. Finn River Farm was another one. This is a different type of stove where they use a 55-gallon top-lit updraft stove and a flame cap kiln. And Finn River, and Brian, I believe Brian is in on this, and Brian could be talking about this, but Brian in 2018, one of those same type of old oil barrels, and this is actually using blueberry trimmings to make biochar, which is then used on the farm. This is blueberry biochar, and this is some, throw the biochar out. The chickens will eat the biochar. They'll poo on the biochar. There was talk about inoculating or charging biochar. Putting it in a chicken coop is an excellent way of doing it. This is a couple other things on the farm that they did on Finn River, where actually these are small 1 gallon top lit updraft stoves that they would cook on in their outdoor kitchen. And then the biochar from these would go in these 55 gallon drums, and they would use that on the farm. This was another one. This is that Orcas Island where you saw the video. This was the 1 cubic yard of biochar where they were getting ready to charge it. And what they did on charge it, they put in different microbe mixes and actually used 5 gallons of seawater. And seawater on dry biochar, all those minerals and nutrients are excellent to get into the biochar to start the charging process. This is for an invasive species, a weed. This is with Brian and I making some biochar at a friend's property in Chimicum. And she kept asking me, can we make biochar with scotch broom? And we said, I don't know, let's try. Well, in an afternoon in 2017, in a couple of hours, we made about 0.5 cubic yard of biochar using scotch broom. I will say one thing about scotch broom, it burns very hot. So be careful when you're using it. This is the WSU workshop that we did at Finn River. And this was a small kiln made out of a 55-gallon drum. And this is actually, and you'll see more pictures of this, in the background here is a 10-foot long by 44-inch in diameter propane tank that's been cut longitudinally. And a local farm donated these to the community. We use them for the workshop. And there are two of these in the community right now. One of them is at the Echo Village in Port Townsend. The other is at Mosaic Farm. They used it a couple of weekends ago for a workshop, and they're using it to make biochar. The beauty of some of these larger ones is that the material could be 9 foot long. You don't have to process it. You can put in 9 foot pieces of material in a 10 foot tank. Whereas in this, which is a 55 gallon drum, you need to keep them about 20, 24 inches in size. This is a different one. It's at the Permaculture Convergence of 2019. This is Kelpie Wilson's design, and she is, I would say, a guru expert. She's an inspiration to me. And I went, and Lowell was at this Permaculture Convergence, and I went specifically to be with Lowell and to meet Kelpie and to make biochar with her. She has plans for these kilns, free access on her website, which is Wilson Biochar. And we will be sending out a list of contact of information. I'm going to get that to Kelly, and she'll send that out. Again, flame cap kiln, using scraps, just materials that were on this farm in Oregon, and to making biochar. This is Mosaic Farm. Mosaic Farm is here in Chimicum. And you, as you can see, there's that same propane tank. And this is burning it in the evening. A couple of weekends ago, they're using it with the chickens in the chicken coops. And it's let nature do the work. Let nature charge your biochar. And they have a tractor that it's movable. And they put in the biochar, then they move it. And that biochar then is being worked into the soil and improving the soil. This is a different way of making biochar. This is at Natembeya Farm. And I believe Brendan is in on this. And Brendan is this is one of the best examples of what I've seen of a conservation burn that Brendan has done out at Natembeya. And these are all fence posts and just scrap material that they've harvested from the at the farm. And it by starting this, the way it's piled, and Brendan can talk about this, start the fire on top, and it burns down. When it burns all the way down, this is the result. This is that biochar made from a burn like this. That biochar is being used out there amongst other things. One thing I know it's being used for is goat bedding. It keeps the smell down, and the nitrogen that normally just gets released to the atmosphere gets absorbed by the biochar. This bedding can then easily be put into compost, and you compost it, and that nitrogen becomes bioavailable to the plants once the compost is finished. The Smithshire, I know that Ronnie's here. This again, using some flame cap kilns in the evening. And this is this year's, it's hard to see some on these, but the root system, and Ronnie can talk about this on some plants that, and I believe they were, tomato plant roots from this year's harvest. And the Smithshire, they've been using biochar. I met Ronnie years ago and they used it initially, my recollection is correct, use some biochar to strengthening the eggs from their egg production. Rosedwyn Echo Village. This was one of the cleanest burns that I've seen. Again, this is another one of those barrels. This was a carpenter doing this. It was all scrap material. And I mean, he laid it in like a carpenter, like a finished carpenter, and Lowell would appreciate this. And he did, this was in June of 2020. Aggenite Pork in Chimicum, they have an agreement with Short's Family Farm, and Short, Roger, furnishes them biochar, which they then put in their pig bedding. The pigs will then root down in that, and they will eat it. Pigs eat it, chickens eat it, cows will eat it. Animals know enough to eat it. It is approved as a feed in Europe, in Australia, not in the United States, but activated carbon is used for medicinal purposes for sick cattle, agriculture cattle. Midnight's Farm, I believe David's located, is on the call also. But they're using it, and they're located on Lopez Island. They mix it in on their wood chips over where they raise cattle, and when they're wintering it, they throw biochar wood chips. It's then, this is the feed bin going in. It's then composted, and in 2019 rolled into this year, they're part of a SARE grant using some commercially produced biochar. Some of it they've gotten from Olympic biochar they got from us, and they're co-composting it with 10% biochar activated in the animal bedding, and then the field trials are being conducted at several farms. David can talk about that a little bit if there's interest. I work closely with Short's Family Farm because Olympic Biochar gets their biochar from the paper mill. It's a byproduct of a steam boiler at the mill. Roger uses it amongst other things. he mixes it in washed dairy manure, which becomes an excellent, it's excellent for the compost, the dairy manure, and the nutrients. One thing about Biochar when one uses it in compost is that it enhances the composting process. You get mature compost in a shorter period of time. Greenhouse gases that would normally get emitted to the atmosphere and become part of climate change issues, they are captured on the Biochar, mainly the nitrogen, and that becomes bioavailable to the plants in the finished compost. And I just want to circle back that is this something that, you know, we went back to the Amazon, but I'm originally from Brooklyn. I actually was born and raised three blocks from this Domino Sugar Factory. The Domino Sugar Factory in 1883 used to use 3 million pounds they produced 3 million pounds of sugar annually using 3 tons of biochar made from bone every day to take the raw brown sugar and make it into white refined sugar. And when I came across that, I just kind of freaked out. I couldn't believe it. It went full circle for me. And for those people that know New York, this bone char was actually made in Central Park before it was Central Park. That's where all the slaughterhouses used to be in the late 1800s. And it was then used in Brooklyn. For those, we're going to get to the point where I want to open this up to questions and everyone, but I just want to make this, and you can write this down. There is a small nonprofit located in Port Townsend that has been giving away this summer biochar super sacks, 1 cubic yards of biochar. They're giving away free and discounted biochar. They've given it away to anyone. They're now limiting it to farms because they're running low on funds. But it's an excellent way for farms to access, and I do know some farms that have access to biochar this way. For me, this is my my email address. If anyone has any questions, you can reach me this way or go to willowbiochar.com. I'm embarrassed by my website. It's kind of minimalistic, but it is there and you can get in contact with me. With that, I'm done with my part of the presentation. I can go back to the screen for our first screen, Kelly, the first one, or I can get rid of sharing screens and people can kind of see each other. So what would you think we should do on that, Kelly?
That sounds good. I like that we can all see each other. And keep in mind, if you all don't write this down, we're gonna follow up with you all with some more resources. So don't worry about trying to write everything down. So.
Yeah, and I apologize for going fast, but I really wanted to leave as much time as possible for the reason of these dirt talks. It's farmers talking to farmers, and I'm just the guy from Brooklyn that loves biochar, so.
Thanks, Francesco. So we can open it up now. If you have any questions, now's a great time to pop them into the chat, or you can unmute yourself and be brave and ask a couple questions. I also wanted to point out, we have some farmers on here tonight who are using biochar, and some of the examples that Francesco had in his presentation are here. So if you're one of those farmers, please feel free to unmute yourself and say hi. And maybe you can tell us all a little bit about your operation on your farm and any other topics.
Hi, this is Lowell. I use biochar. It was actually a byproduct. I found out when I went to Francesco's presentation on making tea LUDs that you could get twice as much energy out of wood in a tea LUD as you do in an open fire. So my whole point in building the tea LUD was to use the energy to pasteurize straw. So I don't waste the heat when I make biochar. In fact, the biochar was a byproduct. I had no idea it had value until Francesco brought Norm Baker over to my house, and he explained to me how I could use it to enrich soil. And he sent me some links that led me to the anthropogenic soil that the ancient farmers along the Amazon used. And I tried to duplicate that, and that's how I came up with Squim Terra Preta. I knew I was onto something when I grew over 40 pounds of tomatoes on one plant.
Thanks, Lowell.
Thanks, Lowell. I see Ronnie's here. Hey, Ronnie, do you want to say a few words?
Okay. Hi, I'm Ronnie from Smithshire in Paulsbo. We've been using biochar for a while. Like Francesco said, we did have learning. There's always so much learning going on a farm, and especially if you're new and you weren't raised in this, things that happen can be really strange. And we actually have a subscription to Acres USA magazine that uncannily, when we seem to be dealing with an issue, that magazine will show up and it'll be in there. The solution will be there. So, and this was one of those situations where we were collecting the eggs and they were breaking, and we were constantly refilling the eggshell or the oyster shell a lot. And it just didn't seem like they were utilizing it. I mean, how can they be consuming so much of this when before they weren't eating very much of it? And the eggs were still breaking. And so I was perplexed about this. I didn't know what to do. And then I got the mail and I opened it up, and right there, it says right on the cover of this Acres USA biochar, and it said something like, is it the solution to your problems or something like this? And so I read the article and I said to my husband, oh my gosh, you're not gonna believe this. But this is the answer. And what was really even more funny was about a month before that, we had a friend give us a book on biochar, and there was instructions on digging a pit, actually, if you can imagine it, in the ground, which I don't recommend anyone do. these contained burns are definitely the way to go. So we had this book, and a friend of ours took it home with him and decided that this was going to be his personal quest. And he came over one day and he dug us a hole. So he's over 6 feet tall, and he dug us a hole that was 12 feet wide and at least 6 feet deep, but it had a ledge inside. So the bottom pit inside of it was only about 4 or 5 feet wide. But he dug us this amazing pit. He turned the sod over perfect, just like it says in the book, because in the book it suggests that you use this sod for the quench instead of water. And so we loaded that thing up, and we used the first time was just very bad, but anyways, it did work out. There was a lot of, we had so much wood in there, and I was able to go, we had a huge burn and it was great fun, and we were able to go to the pit that day after I got the magazine, and I found this big beautiful piece of biochar, and you could hear it was ding 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 glassy, and I was like, that's what the article said. And so I take it out to the chicken area, and we have mobile coops, and we have feeders that are stuck on the side. And I just stuck it right in there where the oyster shell was. And when we went back to do chores that evening, it was gone. They had destroyed this huge, it was at least this big, and they had destroyed it. It was completely gone. And the next day when we collected eggs, they were hard.
Hey Ronnie, I think we're losing you.
Amazing.
Ronnie, you're breaking up.
It increased a little bit. So that they are things that are what it does. So that's the biochar ever since. What else? We use it in our bedding for our chickens and our goats. We also put it directly into our compost. We have a 4-bin composting facility. I don't know the cubic footage of each one, but it's quite large. And we've been putting that in there. This year, I actually took biochar directly and put it in with my tomato plants. And as you may have saw in the presentation that Francesco did, the roots were, I've never seen roots like this. They were pure white. Usually they're like yellow or have some sort of a almost coating of bark on them. But this year they were totally white and they were so long. They were reaching, I have 4-foot or 2-foot rows, and they were reaching across rows to the other rows. And we had huge tomato harvest this year. It was tremendous. I just can't say enough good things about it. And it really does work in litter so well, brings the ammonia down, which can be deceiving because sometimes you do need to change the litter, even though it doesn't smell bad, you should change it. But it's been fabulous for us. And now we put it into our compost.
Hey, Ronnie, we're kind of cutting out.
Try stopping the video. So sometimes that helps with audio.
I just have really high confidence in. Hosta stopped your video.
Hey, Ronnie, okay. I just stopped your video. I think your connection's a little breaking up a little bit.
Yeah, our internet is totally terrible. Let me just turn.
That's okay.
Well, if I could just, because I know part of Ronnie's story and part of it that got lost was she was talking about the eggs after they ate biochar, the eggshells were firm. They were very hard, firm shells.
Okay.
And another thing that one of the things that we've experienced, and a farmer here told me about biochar and tomatoes, is that one of the reasons it's really fantastic is that tomatoes are very sensitive to water. And the fact that biochar retains moisture is that you get a consistent watering moisture to the tomato plant throughout the growing season. So it doesn't go through those variations of wet, dry. It stays more consistent. So also a couple other people. Brendan, would you want to share something?
I'm Brendan. I work at Natumbea, which is on the edge of Port Townsend. And over the last 3 or so years, this place, it's about 100 acres, and it was an old cattle operation for, I don't know, 80 years or so. So there's been a lot of cleanup to do. And over the last several years, a lot of the debris from that process I have constructed into pretty substantial piles. And basically, I think the charcoal that we produce has been kind of like a happy byproduct of this process. In addition to just sort of having fires that don't produce a lot of smoke and are sort of good for the neighborhood. But basically I'll just build a big pile with the tractor, sort of brushy debris in the middle and fence posts and trees and whatnot around the outside, and make sure that everything's relatively dry or as dry as possible. And then light the pile from the top, and it sort of creates this, as the coals fall down, it sort of creates this funnel, and it kind of takes off and just, it just totally goes. And then once it burns down, then we'll start quenching it with water and folding it over. So I'll start raking out the coals and then folding the burn parts over and to sort of move the pile around and rake out coals as it happens, and then quenching it with water. That's pretty much the whole thing. And I think, I don't know about in the yard measurement, but I've been filling up 55-gallon drums, and we'll get four or five a full of charcoal per burn. So I guess that's like, yeah, 250 gallons or something.
And thanks. And then just for reference, a cubic yard is roughly 200 gallons.
Okay.
So, thanks, Brendan. And Brendan, what do you use it for on the farm?
Well, we put it in the compost, in our main large compost, and we put it in with the animal bedding litter. That's primarily, I've been interested in sort of just like traditional charcoal making in general. So I have ideas that someday maybe I'll use it for blacksmithing and for other fuel too. But for now, yeah, we're just using it for something.
Great.
Hey, Brendan, I'm curious, how do you pulverize it?
Most of it, the largest chunks that I've really gotten are sort of softball size, and most of them are smaller than that. And so, I sort of grade it as I sort it, and we're moving it around. And so there's a whole lot of really, really fine material that's easy, that's already pulverized. And the bigger stuff is kind of the stuff that we've kept aside to maybe use for other things in the future. But it's light. There's a lot of cedar. So it's not like it's super, I don't know how quality. I mean, a lot of it's fully pyrolyzed, but so there's also a lot of hawthorn, and the difference between the hawthorn charcoal and the cedar charcoal is drastic. But yeah, it's pretty easy to pulverize it.
Hey, Doug, just on the pulverizing, at that workshop we did on Orcas Island, if you saw, the biochar was laying on a blue tarp. And what they did was, that tarp was over, they folded the tarp over so the biochar was in the tarp, and they just ran over it with a tractor.
Okay.
And broke it that way.
Thanks.
So, one other person I'd like to hear from, I'd like to hear from everyone, but a couple of people, but Brian Bacher has been, we were at that Orcas Island, and Brian would have been with Finn River and Mosaic. So Brian, you want to say a few words?
Yeah. Hi, everybody. I was a little bit late with some technical difficulties to the party. So I missed the first part, and I'm sure Francesco covered a lot. I was first introduced to it because I was working at a blueberry farm, Finn River, and each season they had piles and massive piles of blueberry prunings. And every year they would just burn them in a big open fire instead of, moving them around and dealing with them other ways. It was the easiest way to deal with them. Just take them out of the field and then get them far enough away from the plants and bring them in a big pile. And so Francesco had reached out, or somebody, I think it was somebody, some other worker at the farm had reached out to Francesco about the potential of processing the prunings into biochar. And so that kind of took me down a rabbit hole to learn more about it. And I'm really excited about these ideas of turning prunings. I think that's one of the best uses that you can have for prunings into biochar. And then being able to integrate that on a veggie farming system was really pretty easy, because we're already adding compost and other amendments to veggie beds, and so it was a really easy way to integrate that into kind of the whole picture of the process. I also saw there were some questions earlier about charging it without animals. And I don't know if anybody was excited to answer that. But one thing that we had done is just soaking with fertilizer is a pretty simple way to charge it. So the amount in comparison are a little bit, you can do some more research on that, but either water soluble fertilizers, soaking it for a number of days, and then is a great way to charge the biochar. And then, as Francesco mentioned, co-composting with your kitchen scraps, any hay or straw that you have around, is a great way to inoculate char if you don't have animals. Animals is a great way, but there's tons of ways to do it.
Great. Thanks, Brian. Yeah, I'd like to add a little bit with that is that I know people that use it in composting toilets. I know some people, Norm Baker, that was mentioned, many people will take their biochar and put it in a bucket and urinate on it. And that nitrogen then you can then put that in your compost. But the ways that Brian talks about is with different fertilizers. A simple way is in the fall is you can put actually, if you're amending your beds or your garden in the fall, if you put your amendments on then put some biochar down, put your amendments on, cover it with your mulch or whatever, and then just let nature do the work. By the springtime, it will be pretty much be good to go. So I see that David and Faith are here from Midnight's Farm. I don't know, would you guys want to say a couple of words?
Sure, we could jump in. Yeah, thanks for having this and giving that great introduction and gathering so many people. It's exciting to see such a big group. So thank you for organizing and putting this together. And it's been fun to work with Jessica. Like, I've gone over so we're a ways away, a couple of fair rides, but we have been over and picked up some char from Francesco. But we've also made it here, and we would reiterate Ronnie's thing. We did do a pit burn one time, and that's like, and you know, dug it with our excavator. It was a bit of a nightmare. We had roots burning in it later. It was like, I highly just recommend not. I mean, I would reiterate her recommendation. Don't do that. But we've done it with various methods, and honestly, we haven't really. We've made a lot of smoke and really trying to figure out a way that we make less smoke and trying to figure out how to have both dry material and not be in a burn stage at the, not have a fire risk outside of it. So it's like, and combining those two has been challenging. But we have a pretty big facility. We have a big for the island. So we take yard debris, wood waste from people and turn the wood waste into wood chips. And so, we really are right now kind of trying to find a way to turn some of those wood chips cleanly. They tend to dry out in the big piles. And so we'd like to try to figure out a way to make biochar from those chips at scale to add to our compost facility. So we make like 1,000 yards of compost a year, somewhere in that, maybe a little less than that. But and part of that is from the bedding. We make it, we have cattle, there's some pictures of it in your presentation, but we overwinter cattle and we have pigs also. And in it's hard to afford to do that at anywhere near 10%, and pay, by the time we get here with char or make it. So we're trying to figure out if we could make char more affordably. It's if you're adding 10% char to your compost and suddenly you added and trying to sell it, you got another $20 you're trying to convince your customer to pay. And that's a challenge for us. But the results of this experiment were I think maybe Faith ones. You want to talk about the experiment and where they can find out more about it?
Oh yeah. So we did a SARE grant funded research project with Doug Collins of WSU and Nate Stiesse, and the results are just in, not really compiled, but Nate will be presenting them at one of the sessions at for the TILF conference, which is this Monday, Tuesday. So if you're signed up for TILF, look for the biochar there, and he will be presenting the preliminary information from the research that we did here over the last winter. So, but we've gotten a couple graphs, but we haven't actually gotten the like, what did we learn? We're not sure what we learned yet, unfortunately. But we did mess around with a lot of cattle bedding and adding biochar to it in the pouring rain last winter. So we did put some effort into it. So hopefully we'll get some information out. And then did grow trials, Lopez Harvest, and then Helsing Junction. They did grow trials with broccoli. So sorry, I don't have like actual information about what we did last winter, but it was really fun to work with them and mess around with char.
There's a hand up. Is this a good time to take some questions, Francesco?
Yeah, definitely.
Marley Long, you have your hand up. Do you want to unmute yourself and do you have a question?
Hi. Well, I just found out about this on Facebook, and I'm really excited and surprised to see how many farms in the area are using biochar. And I'm here on the Sahali Learning Center's Eco Village land, and I'm a volunteer. And we recently started using biochar as a way to sequester carbon from the thinning that we're doing in our monoculture, you know, fir forest. So I'm just wanted to let you all know that there's another farm out here that we have been using a pit that we dig in the ground that we dug with our tractor. And we've put it in a place where it's not affecting the roots underground, and it's been working really well for us. We have done the urinate in a bucket and add it to the compost. So I'm glad to hear that that's an approved way of using inoculating biochar, because I've been really afraid to put it in the garden, and I'm worried that it's going to suck up all the nutrients in the soil. But I wanted to clarify that I heard you say that if we added it into the amendments, even if it's not inoculated, and we added, you know, all the layers of mulch on top of it, by the springtime it would be inoculated and ready for use, is what I heard, but I'm not sure.
Yes, that is what I said, and there is a middle school here in Port Townsend that has an orchard, and Doug Van Allen might be able to talk on that. And this is what they do every year, is for the last 3 years they pull back their mulch. They put some biochar down, put some amendments down, put dairy manure on top of that. Doug, you might want to explain what they do there.
We're managing a 70 tree orchard at Blue Heron Middle School, Seth Rowland, myself, and Jim Moore. And we have been spreading, I think we get a yard, Francesco, if I'm remembering right, for the last 3 years. And we've spread that down, and then spread shorts, washed cow manure on top of that, and then put a alder chip mulch on top of that. And then for the dry season, we were also covering it with some agricultural fabric to keep the grass down around the young trees. And it seems to be, I can't say there's any negative effect at all. We're still evaluating the whole system, but when we run soil tests on it, the only thing that we have to be careful about now is salts from the cow manure. So we're probably going to hold off on the cow manure for the next year or two. Generally, we do this spreading on President's Day in whenever that is, January. And so it gives it some time to be charged before the trees really kick in. And plus, there's been so many layers now of mulch and biochar and manure that we feel very comfortable with the charging that's going on. And the trees are healthy. They're the minimal bug damage, and they seem to be growing. The caliper on the trunks is increasing nicely every year. And we had a bumper crop of fruit this year as well.
Thanks, Doug. I just want to add that if anyone knows of David Yarrow, or if you Google David Yarrow, he's really kind of a guru and early time user of biochar in the Finger Lake region of New York. And when I told him what you were going to be doing at the Blue Heron, he said that was the way he would do that. He used to do it at his orchards.
Oh, great.
And also would put some whatever amendments that you might put down, whether they be fertilizers or whatnot, put them in at that time. And especially if you layer the biochar on the bottom during the rainy season, what we have the issue, especially here in the Northwest, is nutrients leaching away. And the biochar will absorb those nutrients.
Yeah, we were very careful to put the biochar down before the manure and the mulch. And last year, we actually also spread, our soil test showed that we were a bit low on nitrogen. So we actually spread cottonseed meal as well in that process. And yeah, that seems to be working well.
Could I jump in here, please?
Please.
Okay. One thing that I would like to point out is that when you use the energy from your burn, from your tea lead, that your energy, and then you put that charcoal back into the soil, your energy use is not just carbon neutral, it's carbon negative. Mm-hmm. You're taking carbon out of the air and putting it in the soil. It'll be bound up in there, as Francesco said, 5,000 to 8,000 years, who knows. My next project that I would like to try is to figure out a way to heat my house using the tea lead so I can have carbon negative energy to heat my house. I don't know how that's going to work out, but that's the next thing I'm going to try to work. But it works flawlessly for pasteurizing straw in my tea lead, because I use, you know, I just heat that water in that barrel. So another point about leaching, the energy leaching out, is that when I mix the biochar with worm castings and put it in a raised bed, I have raised beds that are, I like them up high. So I'm getting kind of old. I don't like to work down by the ground. So I like to garden up here at chest level. And so my raised beds aren't even connected to the ground. So there's no way that the nutrients from the Spim Terra Preta can leach into the soil.
Hey, Francesco, we just concluded a growing groceries class where most of the participants did soil testing and found out that they were very high in phosphorus in their tests, like almost off the chart in some cases. Do you know how well biochar can lock up some of that phosphorus? Speaking of leaching out, we want to avoid having excess phosphorus run into our water sources.
My understanding is that it will bind up. There is more and more research going on that. And if, I don't know where you had your soils test done, but a great resource is check out growabundant.com. The people, Erica at Grow Abundant is excellent. She's an excellent resource. And she also, they have something called OrganiCalc. They're hooked up with the Logan Labs, where when you send the results, give them the results of your soils test from these a couple of specific labs, and they will give back recommendations, specifically phosphorus, calcium, nitrogen, whatever you may need. So check out Grow Abundant, and Grow Abundant will be a part of the resource list that will be sent out.
Great, thank you.
A couple other questions in the chat. I just wanted to make sure if Valerie, Terry, if you got your question answered about how is the charging process done, or if you wanted to clarify that further.
I could jump in a little bit on that. One of the resources we'll send out, there's some simple ways of doing it. Depending on how big, I mean, if you're just a gardener, a small-time gardener with a few beds, you can get some worm tea, worm leachate, something liquid that you can immerse your biochar in. And don't want it to go anaerobic, but immerse it in that and let it activate. You can use some beneficial microbes in that mix. I've witnessed Brian doing it in a 55-gallon drum with a little bubbler so that you had the aerating going. Simple way, one can take some compost that is newly created, if one hasn't used biochar to make the bio the compost, is that even use it in the compost making process, you can mix some biochar with that compost. The one thing that I would caution against, it's not so much a caution, but advise, that biochar in and of itself does not have any nutrients. Initially, it will absorb nutrients. So if you put biochar in your bed, raw biochar, it will compete with whatever you have planted. Over a period of time, there are Dr. Norm Baker that we referred to. He states, if you look at it, it's over three, four, 5 years that you really start seeing results of biochar giving back, and then it will continue to give back. So biochar is not an amendment that you have to keep putting every year. Once you get a concentration in there, and I would recommend no more than 10% by volume in your 6 inches of soil in your growing bed, that do soils tests, see what you need, add those little bit of minerals in that you might need. So I hope that answered the question a little bit more.
I have a comment on that. I find that I use the kind of a tray that a mason uses to mix mortar with a hoe. Bought it at the Home Depot. And I'll put the biochar in there about 4 inches deep, and I just keep dumping worm leachate in there and let it evaporate away. It doesn't go anaerobic because it has all that surface area, and it only takes 6 weeks to 2 months of doing that, and then you can put that biochar into your raised bed. And I've used concentrations of 20%, and it works flawlessly. It seems to be completely charged by that point, and it is a benefit to the soil. I can definitely tell you that.
Yeah, and I just want to take on to what Lowell is saying. We did some soils tests on Lowell's raised bed 4 years ago, and then did another one this spring. And I forget, I don't have the raw data in front of me, but the cation exchange capacity is just, it's increasing. His carbon content is increasing in these raised beds. So yeah,
it went from 15, the cation exchange rate went from 15 to over 19. Mm-hmm. And I hadn't added anything to that. I had just been continuous. In fact, I grow two crops a year in there because I grow winter crops and summer crops in these raised beds by putting a little plastic cover over. And I was surprised that soil, it, not only was it not depleting, but it was actually increasing in the ability to exchange nutrients. So Norm was impressed by the fact that the organic component of the soil was increasing. And he understands a lot more about that than I do. So I am blessed with people who understand this better than I do, because I had this happen and I asked Norm and Francesco and I said, what just happened? And they explained it to me, but a lot of what they were explaining was way over my head.
Another thing I like to add to the group is I like to think that all of you that are using, working with biochar and playing with biochar, you're joining the League of Citizen Sciences, because science, when you know, mainstream science, university science, they are just catching up to. They have made for years some basic mistakes, errors in using biochar, and then wondering why it doesn't work. Norm and I were at biochar conferences, and they say, well, we put it in and it had no effect at all. And we asked them, well, did you charge it anyway? No, we just put in raw biochar. So put in, observe, maybe don't do the whole thing, do half a bed or do one bed in a different bed. See, and observe what the differences are. I work with one community garden in our neighborhood here, and the woman there is pretty amazing. She says, you know, initially I wasn't sure, you know, I've seen it doing things, but boy, this is the fourth year, and I am amazed at what that bed with the biochar and mineral balancing of what it's doing now after 4 years. So play with it. And if, you know, and if you can't make a mistake, I mean, you really can't.
I have a question kind of related to that, I guess. You know, some of the farmers talked about some of the feedstocks they use. You know, Brendan, I was really curious about cedar versus your hawthorn, and I thought it was really innovative about scotch broom and the noxious weeds. Can some of you talk a little bit more about that sourcing, I guess, feedstocks? I can't think of any other word, but are there any materials that you would advise against, or is it more just what's available?
I would say don't use any treated lumber. Definitely don't use any treated lumber. Anything that might have lead-based paints on it. And then your biochar is a product of it's of what the temperatures of the process are. So if you have a higher temperature burn, you're going to get a different type. If you get a biochar that's burning in one of these kilns that's pushing, that's maybe about 600 degrees, 500 degrees, it's going to be a different properties of your biochar than if it's at 300 degrees. They are still biochar. And the different food, the different stock, you know, feedstock, whether it be cedar or alder or Doug fir, you will see the properties as Brendan has seen. You know, you say you use a lot of cedar. It's a softer wood. It's a softer biochar than some of your harder ones. And Brendan, I don't know how many different ones you have.
You mean different types of wood, or?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, mostly cedar, but also Douglas fir and hawthorn and various types of fruit and nut wood. I mean, yeah, I think as far as the materials that go, there's just always a lot of debris to process, and yeah, I think that's part of the sort of conservation style burn is have these really hot fires that don't produce a lot of smoke, and they burn really fast. And then, you know, if we can get a useful byproduct from that, that's awesome. I can't really speak to sort of the, you know, the different effects of them in the soil, you know, as far as the different surface areas or not. I mean, but you can feel the difference of the density of the different materials. Like, it's easy to pick them out of the pile. And yeah.
I have an answer to a question that was asked earlier. I put my biochar through a hammer mill. I have to put a shroud around it because it pulverizes it so completely that it would blow away in the breeze. So I use a cardboard and, you know, kind of tape it together with masking tape so that the this fine charcoal still ends up in the pile underneath. And that seems to make it, well, one thing for sure is when you mix it with your soil, it sure turns black. And in a raised bed under plastic, that black soil is nice because it gets really hot really quick when the sun shines on it.
Yeah.
Hey Brian, I recall you talking about when we did that workshop a couple of weeks ago out at Mosaic, you were talking about the properties of your blueberry biochar. From the blueberry trimmings.
Yeah, so one thing that's nice about using prunings in those flame cap kilns is generally the particle size after the burn is already ready to go into the soil. There's no further processing required. And, you know, with, as Brendan mentioned, with softer woods too, they tend to fall apart really easily, even if they are in bigger chunks. But yeah, I would just echo what Brendan said. The density of the wood is likely going to just increase the surface area, increase the carbon content of what ends up in the soil, which potentially has, you know, more holding capacity, what is what I would see as a major difference. And denser wood will probably last longer in the soil, although we still are working in time scales of thousands of years. So it's a little bit irrelevant in that case. But the different feedstocks, I guess, I mean, primarily if you had your choice of feedstocks, hardwoods are also really good for other things too. And so I would just use whatever's abundant, whatever's on hand. Would be the way to go. I mean, yeah, whatever you got that can make it is a good feedstock.
Any other questions, comments?
I just wanted to add an observation because I saw that there was a John that talked about some tomato plants. I live on a small, less than 5,000 square foot lot here in Port Townsend. And and we're also plagued with deer and whatnot. So we have a little enclosure on our deck in 20 gallon pots. We had two tomato plants, actually three, but the two tomato plants that were Sun Gold. And that mix that we used, it was biochar from in our compost. We used some pellets from Pacific Grow, which was a byproduct that was what they were doing. They were testing out a new product. So it was with their Pacific Grow, which is a fish-based product that they do. They have a liquid that they sell. And in those pots, we grew, and they went up to the gutters on our house because they're on our deck. They stood about 8 foot tall. We gave them a fish emulsion once in the growing season. And that was it. We didn't feed them anything except for what was in that soil when we gave from the beginning. and I've got a freezer full of tomatoes right now. So, and when I pull out the, and Ronnie was talking about the roots, these tomato plants are root bound in 20 gallon pots. It's just, yeah. So.
Yeah, that's great. We had a very similar experience with ours. You know what? I have a. I'm in Salt Lake City, Utah, and thank you for doing this. This is a has been a wonderful experience. I do have a question for your farmers. I'm trying to understand how to get more of our product. We only go with local waste streams to convert to biochar. It's all responsible. It's all about the carbon accounting. I'm having a hard time getting in with the farming communities in Utah. It seems like it's the technology is so old that they feel like it doesn't make sense. They're stuck on the concept of fertilizer and chemical inputs. So I'm trying to find a way around that. I'm slowly getting that with some alfalfa farmers, doing a lot of weed abatement and soil remediation, and working on a bunch of land grant processes. But as a farmer and a grower, how do we talk to more of you in order to spread the word? Or do we need to rely upon you to be that advocate?
I have an answer, sort of an answer. I'm a carpenter, and I find out, I'm an interior trim carpenter, but usually when I show up on the site, there's all kinds of rafter tails, leftover cutoff 2x4s, little pieces of wood. And usually if you ask the builder or whoever's in charge, you mind if I haul off a pickup load of that wood? They go, well, yes, you're actually saving them money by hauling it away. Doug fir, hemlock, softwood that's used for framing houses makes wonderful biochar. And when you put it through a hammer mill, it's like flour.
Right.
I have a couple of thoughts. I think if you think about, there's so much research coming out about biochar right now, and it's like looking at drought resilience and looking at there's research coming out that you don't need to use as much fertilizer if it's mixed with biochar. And, so there's some real concrete, ways to talk about it that really address the bottom line. It's like you have greater resilience, especially I'm thinking in a dry climate, and the bottom line as far as not needing as many inputs. And there's lots of resources. There, Jim Aminet's papers that are, they're more Northwest based, but they are really fantastic and get into a lot of the science of it. So that would be, a place where I would start is really, it's like the carbon piece, but there's also the bottom line and the economics of it. And if you can talk both languages, that's often helpful, especially for opening the door.
Yeah, thank you.
John? The other part,
I would just jump in. The other part is trying to find some, those key, farmers who people look to and get them using it. Mm-hmm. I don't know how you. In Washington, it's the Washington State University people, and those people that probably in Utah would be the same people mm-hmm. that might get your word out. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're working with Utah State University's Extension. They have a location in Park City. Here in Salt Lake and up in Logan. So, my personal experience speaks volumes to the benefit that this can bring to some really degraded soils and even the benefits it brings to healthy soils. So it's just.
John, I'm curious, are you coupling this at all with no-till or low-till strategies?
Oh, my alfalfa farmer tills his field like mad and it drives me nuts. But he's also big on EM1. So he's adding he's going with some heavy biological inputs on top, and he co-composts the biochar. He's a fifth generation farmer, and he his dad has about 40 head, and so they just put this in the pens, let them overwinter on it, and then spread it on the fields. Another farmer I have down in Torrey is using it in their greenhouse, but they're feeding it to their hens. They're putting it in their with their goats and rabbits and their cattle herd as well, and then spreading it on their alfalfa field. They do the blocked off pasture process to get the animal biology going in the field as well. So in Utah, I mean, we're a desert, and they just want to keep tilling the ground. So it's, again, it's the whole idea, till it, load it with chemicals. And, you know, it's like, well, I have a way that can help you with your water management. And I'm guessing your water is one of your most precious resources, and you can build the soil carbon, and you can make it so any rain that does fall stays, and you keep that water profile strong in your soil. And then hopefully we're going to let you see at least 16% improvement on your yield factor. So, and of course, it's like, you can't put anything in writing that it's going to, I can't guarantee that you're going to see the 16% on the first year. You'll see some improvement on your near horizon yield, but it's the term. It's like all my conversations are about 3 years. When I talk to the farmers, I don't say anything about carbon sequestration. It's all about reduce costs, improve the quality of your soil, protect your investments. So anyway, but I just like if I had a room full of farmers like I see here today, I would be super happy. There's literally only, I've got a few CSAs that I work with, and then just only like two farmers, and then the land grant conservancies that I'm working with up in Summit County around the Olympic events facilities, some of that. But yeah, what you folks are doing is wonderful.
Hey, here on the left coast, we like carbon sequestration.
I love it too. A 5 gallon bucket's 25 pounds of atmospheric carbon, and like I try not to sell within any further than 250 miles of downtown Salt Lake where we produce it. We use a pyrolyzer. It's a really nice pyrolyzer. It's about 900,000. We participate on that. There was an energy company that had created it thinking they'd be making a bio oil, and the market just fell through on that. But we're looking at finding ways to capture the heat. We use the heat to dry the feedstock, and the feedstock, because effectively what we're doing is we're taking organic matter that somebody thinks they have to throw away. We're converting it into a value stream. But we also track it very closely because I need to make sure that I'm accountable for what goes in the soils. But yeah, this is like, I'm just so happy to meet up with you folks. So thank you.
Thanks. Hey, John, is your pyrolyzer continuous feed?
Yes. It's an auger driven. I have some little screenshots of it and some videos on my Instagram page. Instagram/GoBiochar.
Okay.
You can see those. If you search Amaron, AMARON energy on YouTube, you can see some of the WSU extension videos where they highlight the Amaron pyrolyzer. But what you would see in that is effectively the same thing that you see on my Instagram page. But we use a half inch and smaller wood chip size. So there is some processing that's required. But if you're going for kind of that mid scale, I would really encourage. So he calls himself Dr. T. Ludd. He's got a new version of the Art Rock, the ROCC kiln. And it's brand new. Releasing the plans this next week. In fact, he was on another webinar last week talking about how he's going to be launching it. That is great for the mid-scale, and the production cost for that process is not too expensive. It does require some labor, but it's nominal, especially for the quality that of the char it appears to produce. So I went through the IBI training and I've done all of that. And I'm getting into the other processes as well. So,
and the one thing with it, I know Paul Anderson, Dr. Tilot, both yeah. Jane and I, he was on this call, we worked with him for years. And he was the first one that when I'm working with a Tilot at that ethos conference I talked about. The one thing that is in this community, and I'm so grateful to be in the community that we are, is that there are so many farms that I find out more and more people that are on this, that are running these small farms, that are either making and or using and purchasing biochar. We're graced in this community also with the biochar that we have. An Olympic biochar is a byproduct of a steam boiler at the local paper mill. So I have people that they start making it and they say, you know, I just don't have time to make it. Let me buy some. And so it's a combination. It's not an either or in this case, it's an and.
Yes.
And one of the things that someone said years ago, and I forget who it was, but don't let perfection get in the way of putting biochar in the ground. Mm-hmm. So however you make your biochar, even if it's not completely charred, if it's torrefied, so you got some material, you put it in it, there are microbes and things in the ground they're gonna eat that. It's food for them. So get it in the ground, start using it. And someone mentioned the carbon sequestration factor of it. When you're sequestering over 50% of the carbon of your feedstock. And that's a lot. And the reason that you're able to do that is because it's the hydrocarbons that are burning off and not the carbon. So, yeah.
Thanks, Francesco. We are almost at time. It's 6:29 and we're scheduled to go to 6:30, and I wanna be respectful of everyone's time. Is there any last questions from anyone who hasn't had a chance to ask a question, or please feel free to unmute yourself or pop in the chat.
Hi, this is Ronnie, and I want to ask John a question. I did look while he was talking, I went and looked at his Instagram, and I'm seeing here about using the biochar powder to preserve seeds. And I think this is fascinating. And I think this is something that all farmers should know. I mean, I think I don't know how many people actually keep their own seeds, but for us, it's something that's very important. We consider ourselves to be a homestead. And I think this is fascinating and something that should be added to the list of great things that biochar does.
Yeah, you know what? It's, I think Kelpie or somebody worked on it. There's a document out there, 55 uses for biochar. I mean, there's literally thousands, but yeah, you want to, when you do it with your seeds, just so you know, make sure that you dry it out really well first. Put it in the oven when your cookies or when the oven after you bake something is cooling down and it gets below 200 degrees. Because if you're above that, it's going to heat back up and it's going to catch fire and you're going to smoke your house. Don't ask how I know that, but just be careful with it. But dry it out first, and then if you powder it up a bit and mix it in and do a good coating. And then the other thing that I swear by is mycorrhizal fungi. I put some of that in there as well. And then every time I do any type of transplant event, I'm coat the root zone in mycorrhizal, and between there's just an absolute concert that appears to happen when you have your biochar, some level of biology, and then your mycorrhizae. It's really fantastic. So, but when I'm storing my seed, I'm putting a little poke of the mycorrhizal in there as well as the biochar. But again, make sure your biochar is bone dry, because if not, you do have a risk of getting some mold unless you keep it in an open container.
When you do the root inoculation with the biochar and the mycorrhizal fungi, do you do that wet?
No, when I'm storing it, I it's all dry. But when I'm going to germinate, to do starts, that will be wet at that time, or I'll mix it dry and put it into the properly treated medium.
When you do so I know for us, we do permaculture and we've always done the mycorrhizal fungi. We usually mix it with some water and then inoculate the roots. And so I was just wondering if when you do your root inoculation, do you also add just biochar powder? Do you do that?
I've only recently started to do it. So the biochar that we produce has a mix of larger bits and then also some powder. And so what I would do is I would just sift out some of the powder and put that in with my starts. But I haven't really worried about saying I need to use a powder or I need to use chunk. Mostly I just am anxious in getting the biochar and the mycorrhizae to all work together in the rhizosphere and the root zone. So when I'm planting on a hill, I create a zone, mix it all up and put it in there. But the mycorrhizae is as close to the root zone as possible. I'm a lot more lazy about just the general use of biochar in the rest of the area. It's so dry here that I really have to make sure that I use it. There was a really great paper that came out just a few weeks ago identifying a 40% water use reduction in areas that are subject to drought. And, I can pretty well attest to that because we just had a horrible drought this summer here in Utah. So it works. But I have a greenhouse grower who, he put the raw biochar. I gave him some raw biochar in early March before the pandemic hit. And he put it in his, if you look on some of my earlier Instagram photos, he put it in with just his healthy soil. And the difference in the pepper plants and the tomato plants, and those are the same. And I got a lot of those pepper plants and a lot of those tomato plants, and those are the tomato plants that went up to 9 feet for me. We had a wind event here where we had 112 mile an hour winds in our neighborhood, and then a cold front that dropped down to 30 degrees about a month ago, and it decimated everybody's gardens. But until then, they were going big, and I was pretty sure I was going to get over 10 foot. I had built some 10 foot trellises. And but again, I think, the best biochar is whatever's ideal for your application. There are lots of ways to make it, both in farm, on premise, or through some of the producers that have the pyrolyzers or other methods, knowing what your application is. So Francesco was talking about some of the lower temperature biochars. Those have a lower pH and they happen to be really enjoyed by trees. So if you're doing tree plantings and you have a lower temp biochar, those are going to pair really well together. So, it all depends on what your application is. So, and then I'll do whatever my inoculants are. I'll try and work with the customer to find out what their needs are. I'll do the research. I'll call the folks at the extension to see if they have any inputs, but mostly I just am trolling. I probably spend 20 to 30 hours a week just reading technical documents and learning about this. I've been doing it for about a year and a half now. And I love biochar. It's really amazing. So.
Well, thanks for being here, John. It's great. We have someone from Utah. That's unexpected. We just have these dirt talks for our little Olympic and Kitsap Peninsula area of the world. So we're really happy to have you here. But with that, I'm going to have to call it a night, everybody. We're past our time and we've lost some people tonight. So I just wanted to wrap up and say thank you so much to all of our farmers and Francesco for working with me on putting this on, and Jess Sappington, my colleague in Kitsap County. And Yes, thank you. And just know that this will be recorded and it will be sent to you all after this webinar, and we'll have all our this recording on our YouTube channel. So keep a lookout. And I put my information, my contact information in the chat, as well as a link to our website. If you want to learn more about upcoming Dirt Talks, you can join our, you could subscribe to our listserv and our newsletter. So check it out. And thank you so much.
I just want to add one safety thing. Once, if people that start making biochar and start using a lot of biochar and working with it a lot, wear respirator or good face masks, wear goggles. You're thinking of, think of black lung, think of coal dust. The finer the particles they get in your lungs, they don't come out. So that's all. And thanks, everybody.
All right. Everyone have a great night, and thank you for joining us.